from the JAMA Network. This is JAMA Author Interviews. Conversations with authors exploring the latest clinical research, reviews, and opinion featured in JAMA.
Hello, and welcome to our listeners around the world. You're listening to JAMA Author Interviews. Thanks so much for joining us. I'm your host, JAMA Associate Editor, Dr. Karen Joynt Maddox, and today I'm excited to be discussing a paper called Changes in Patient Care Experience After Private Equity Acquisition of U.S. Hospitals with my friend and colleague, Dr. Rishi Wadhera. Dr. Wadhera is a practicing cardiologist, associate professor of medicine at Harvard Medical School, and the associate director of the Richard A. and Susan F. Smith Center for Outcomes Research at Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center. Thanks so much for being here with me today, Rishi.
Thanks so much for having me, Karen.
So let's start with the basics. So private equity is a hot topic right now. There's been a lot of press, a growing amount of research. There's a lot of attention. But can you level set for us and just start by explaining what is private equity and why are people worried about its role in healthcare?
Yes, definitely. Private equity firms use capital from institutional investors and borrowed money to acquire healthcare entities, including hospitals, outpatient practices, and nursing homes. And that debt from the borrowed money is then placed on the acquired healthcare organization, such as a hospital and its physical assets. And there are a few reasons why private equity's involvement in healthcare has attracted widespread attention, as well as scrutiny from healthcare leaders, the public, and Congress. First, we've seen an explosion of private equity deals in healthcare. Over the past decade alone, private equity transactions on healthcare deals have totaled approximately $1 trillion. More than 450 hospitals are now owned by private equity firms. And these firms have also rapidly acquired outpatient practices across different medical specialties, most notably dermatology, ophthalmology, and more recently, cardiology. And so some folks have argued that private equity firms can provide much needed capital resources and managerial expertise to help hospitals that may be struggling, but private equity firms have a strong incentive to rapidly generate financial gains for their investors over a relatively short time horizon, typically 5 to 7 years. And as a result, there's been substantial concern that private equity may impose structural changes and cost-cutting practices after acquisition, such as reduced staffing in hospitals, that maximize profits at the expense of patient care and outcomes.
So it's sort of hyper-corporatization of healthcare, right? We've basically got a lot of intense money management business coming into healthcare. And so with that background, let's talk a little bit about your study in particular. So you're looking at patient experience in the hospital setting. So sounds a little self-explanatory, but can you tell us, how do you measure patient experience? What are we talking about when we talk about patient experience?
Yes. Well, first of all, I think understanding how patients perceive their own hospital experience can provide us with a really unique patient-centered view on quality of care during a hospitalization. And it captures important elements of the care experience that more traditional quality measures are unable to assess. So to evaluate how patient care experience changed after hospitals were acquired by private equity firms compared to a matched control group of hospitals that were not acquired, we used the Hospital Consumer Assessment of Healthcare Providers and Systems Survey. And that's a mouthful. So it's also known as the HCAHPS survey. And HCAHPS is a national standardized survey that asks 19 core questions about critical aspects of patients' hospital experience, such as communication with nurses and doctors, responsiveness of hospital staff, and overall rating of a hospital. And this is a survey that's administered monthly to a random sample of discharged patients. And more than 2.5 million surveys are completed across the country annually. And HCAHPS is used widely, including to evaluate U.S. hospital performance as part of Medicare's National Public Reporting Quality and Payment Programs. And the main outcomes of our study were really two global measures of patient care experience from HCAHPS. The first was patients' overall rating of a hospital on a scale from 0 to 10, with 0 being the worst and 10 being the best possible rating. And the second primary outcome was patients' willingness to recommend a hospital. We also evaluated 7 other secondary outcomes from HCAHPS, focused on patients' perceptions of clinical processes, such as staff responsiveness and discharge instructions, communication with nurses, doctors, and about medications, and hospital cleanliness and quietness.
Got it. good to know that these are things that are used nationally. So standardized, used nationally, used across a bunch of hospitals and done frequently. So you have a pretty big sample of data to look at here if you're trying to understand how private equity impacts these measures of patient experience. Okay. So we have a bunch of hospitals that are acquired by private equity. We've got a measure trying to understand how that might change what a patient actually sees and hears and feels and how they're treated in the hospital. And you've got national data to work with. So with that setup, give us the punchline. So what did you find?
Our top line finding was that global measures of patient care experience significantly worsened after US hospitals were acquired by private equity firms. As an example, the percentage of patients rating hospitals as a 9 or 10 out of 10 decreased at private equity acquired hospitals compared with matched control hospitals, as did the percentage of patients who would definitely recommend the hospital. And the difference in global measures of patient care experience between private equity acquired and control hospitals actually grew with each year following acquisition, totaling 5 percentage points by post-acquisition year 3. And just for context, this decline in overall patient care experience that we observed after private equity acquisition exceeded the decline in patient care experience scores observed nationally during the COVID-19 pandemic, a major public health crisis. We also found that patient-reported responsiveness of hospital staff worsened after hospitals were acquired by private equity, although there were no significant changes across other measures of clinical processes, communication, and hospital environment.
Okay, so that's fascinating. So you're finding that patient experience was worsened over time, particularly at acquired hospitals compared to controls. And I want to dial in on that last thing you said, which is that there was a big decrease in the patient reported responsiveness of staff, because I think that's something you said in your introduction. We might worry that a private equity acquired hospital, there might be changes in staffing as a result of that acquisition. So can you put that in context with what we might know more broadly about staffing, or did that make sense to you? Tell me more about that finding.
One of the easiest ways for private equity firms, when they come in and acquire a hospital, to cut costs is by reducing staffing. And of course, the primary concern is if you reduce staffing too much, it could have adverse effects on patient care experience and also patient outcomes. And I think, you know, you put that finding in the broader context of what we know or what the evidence to date suggests about how private equity acquisitions of US hospitals affect outcomes. Several studies have recently asked this question, and one recent analysis that was published in JAMA found that Medicare patients admitted to private equity hospitals experienced a 25% increase in adverse hospital events like falls and central line associated bloodstream infections compared to those treated at non-acquired control hospitals. And so I think our findings build upon this recent work by demonstrating that patient-reported care experience, a critically important dimension of care quality that provides us with a unique lens into patients' interactions with healthcare systems, also worsens after private equity acquisitions. And that's really important because we know that patient experience scores are strongly linked with other important outcomes like patient safety and mortality. And so I think taking a step back, really the totality of the evidence to date suggests that multiple domains of quality worsen after US hospitals are acquired by private equity. And I think the question that you ask sort of hits a nail on the head, so to speak, that you have to wonder if the mechanism or one of the possible explanations for multiple studies finding that different domains of quality worsen is that private equity firms are coming in and reducing hospital staffing as a cost-cutting strategy to maximize profits. And I think that's sort of concordant with our finding that you highlighted, that hospital staff responsiveness decreased after private equity acquisition.
Yeah, I think one thing that's so unique about healthcare is that we're not widgets, right? Like, this is a person-focused, individual-to-individual caregiving industry.
And exactly,
I think that's the important piece of the patient experience measure. It's sort of a way to pick up that part of it that is actually really important to patients getting better and getting better in the hospital and, you know, being able to rejoin their families and do what they want in the long run. So really appreciate you highlighting this piece of quality, which I think sometimes we forget about, but as you say, is really crucially linked to other outcomes and maybe pretty central to maybe where we've gone wrong in some of our healthcare conversations. So put your big picture hat on here, what should policymakers do with this? What are sort of the main takeaways for what this tells you about the broader ecosystem?
It's a great question. I think that what we're learning is that private equity acquisitions of hospitals and other healthcare entities like outpatient practices and nursing homes require more oversight. And many proposals have been put forward. Some of the ones that I think are tenable and feasible include increased transparency and monitoring of private equity deals in healthcare, reducing the monetary threshold for mandatory reporting private equity deals to the SEC or for federal regulatory review, and granting state attorney generals more authority to block private equity healthcare deals that have the potential to adversely impact competition or patient care. I think it's become abundantly clear that policymakers need to respond to the surge of private equity deals in healthcare with thoughtful, evidence-based guardrails to ensure that these transactions do not adversely impact patient care and outcomes.
Yeah, I think probably many listeners would be surprised to hear. I was certainly surprised to learn that many of these deals do fly under the radar.
Yeah.
And really aren't monitored. We're doing these post hoc analyses where we're looking back and saying what happened over the last decade, as opposed to knowing a month later, 2 months later, 6 months later, what may be happening in some of these places. So really appreciate you bringing up those broader points. It's certainly a moment in healthcare corporatization right now, and we'll see what happens going forward with both private equity and other forms of profit. But I think you raised some really important points about how regulators can help us to try to protect patients and still take advantage of whatever efficiencies and management private equity is bringing to the table. Patients still need to come first. And I think looking at patient experience is a great way to do that. So I want to give you a moment to give a shout out to your co-authors and add anything else that you might like your listeners to hear before we close the episode.
Thank you. I just really wanted to highlight that this work was spearheaded by a terrific research fellow at the Smith Center and a internal medicine resident at Johns Hopkins, Dr. Anjali Batla, along with a resident at Brigham and Women's Hospital, Dr. Vicky Bartlett, and a medical student at Harvard, Dr. Michael Liu.
Great. So the future of our healthcare system
is in good hands.
Is in good hands. Great. Well, thank you so much for speaking with me today. This was incredibly interesting. So important as we move forward in this healthcare landscape, and we're just glad that all of you are doing the work. I'm Dr. Karen Joynt Maddox, and I've been speaking with Dr. Rishi Wadhera about his work on private equity and hospital care. You can find a link to the article in this episode's description. This episode was produced by Daniel Masusi at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved, including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.